Well, it's an honor to be here. I have spoken in Lincoln before, but this is my first time to this campus. And I think I've drawn a bigger crowd here than in Lincoln, so I'm very appreciative. It was March 19th of 2003. I was living in Fairhope, Alabama, near to Mobile, and it was about time for the evening news to come on, so I turned on my TV set to channel 15 NBC out of Mobile, and the announcer said, "We open tonight's news with a breaking story out of Birmingham, Alabama. Massive accounting fraud uncovered at HealthSouth. It's estimated that there's almost $3 billion worth of bogus numbers on their books." At that moment, I knew probably in the not too distant future, I would be in prison. How did it all begin? I first met Richard Scrushy in the summer of 1980. I was living in Houston, Texas, and I'd recently passed the CPA exam. I actually majored in economics when I was in college, but after being out of school for more than 10 years, I'd taken enough accounting that I could sit for the exam, and I passed it. And I was at a point in my career where I wanted to go to work for a large company. I'd always worked for other small companies. I'd never actually worked with or for another CPA. So I answered an ad in the Houston Chronicle for a controller position at Lifemark Corporation, a New York Stock Exchange hospital company. And I went in for the job interview, and it was with Richard Scrushy. And I immediately knew I'd met somebody very different. All during the job interview, my head was just spinning. I was dazzled by the guy. And by the end of the interview, I was totally convinced that that was the very best job I could have in Houston, Texas. But as I was driving home, I kept thinking about the guy. When I got home, I told my wife that I thought I'd met the most brilliant businessman I might ever meet, or maybe the biggest con artist I would ever meet. Richard offered me the job. I reported to work. And I'd been at my desk for 5 minutes. I just walked in the front door. And Richard came into my office and he said, "Aaron, I'm presenting a contract to my boss, and it's a contract I think we should sign. I'd like for you to sit in on my presentation." I said, "Sure, Richard." We went into his boss's office, he introduced me, and he said, "Aaron and I worked on this contract for hours last night." I hadn't worked on anything. I just walked in the front door. Today, after everything that's happened, I truly believe that Richard told that lie to size me up. He wanted to see how I would behave being included in a lie. It would tell him a lot about my personality. I didn't think a lot about it. I'm not a very confrontational kind of person. I thought he's just trying to make me look good. And I didn't take him to task over it. I worked for Richard for almost 4 years. And the first thing you learn about Richard is he has a very big ego. I mean, a really, really, really big ego. But he's a talented businessman, and I learned a lot from him. But after being there for about 4 years, I came in one morning, and I picked up my Wall Street Journal, and the headline said, "Lifemark and AMI to merge." They were both New York Stock Exchange hospital companies. And the article said they'd be closing the offices in Houston, Texas. And I thought, yeah, man. I'm about to be unemployed here. Or maybe I'll get a job with a new firm in California. I don't know. But what happens when large companies like this merge? Venture capitalists will come around to see if someone has an idea for a startup company, because people do get laid off in these types of mergers. Citicorp Venture Capital contacted Bill Mackey, the chairman of the board, and asked if there was such a person. And Mr. Mackey said, "Richard Scrushy is your man. He's absolutely brilliant. We made him a full vice president when he was only 26 years old. And he's been talking to us about doing more things outside of the hospital." Back in the early 1980s, most healthcare procedures were done inside of the hospital. But even back then, the cost of healthcare was front page news. and people were trying to come up with ways to lower healthcare costs. Richard's concept was, get people out of the hospital as soon as you can. One of the most expensive places in the world to spend a night is in an acute care hospital. For example, if somebody's been in an automobile accident and after their acute care stay, they need physical therapy, send them home. Let them come back and get it as an outpatient in a much lower cost setting. He convinced Citicorp to put $1 million into a startup company to open a chain of outpatient rehabilitation centers. Now, he needed a management team, he needed a CFO, and he wanted me to be that CFO. And I wasn't too excited about following him with his new company. I'd learned they'd tell lots of white lies, his ego was oppressive, but he's a good salesman. He said, Aaron, put in $5,000. You'll get 100,000 shares in the company. That's a nickel a share. He said, you got to realize Citicorp is paying $1 a share for their 1 million shares. So your $5,000 is already worth $100,000 based on what Citicorp is paying. I knew Richard could build a big company. He's a good businessman, very aggressive, and I liked the concept. I thought a company that would lower healthcare costs made sense. So I made the decision to go with Richard in his new company. Now, Richard was from Alabama, so we moved to Birmingham, Alabama, and we opened our first outpatient center, and we tried to make it look like a fitness center or a spa. We did not want the patient to feel like they were going back into a building full of sick people. We charged less than the acute care hospitals did for the same procedures, and it worked. Our first center made more money than we thought it would. It broke even sooner than we thought it would. And I knew early on that I was on the ground floor of something pretty exciting. During this first year, when we only had about maybe 10 or 15 people in the corporate office, I'm very much a morning person. I was usually first person in the office every morning. But I came in one morning and Richard had gotten into the office before me. And he had drawn this stick figure image of people pulling a wagon. And when everybody got there, he gave us like a motivational speech. He said, look, you're not all pulling the wagon. He said, these two guys out front holding the handle are doing a pretty good job. He said, but some of you guys are riding in the wagon. This guy's pulling it backwards. This guy's just kind of fat and dumb on the sidelines, not contributing anything. And it became a company motto, pull the wagon. And he left that crude drawing up in the lobby, a flip chart in our corporate office. And as the years went by, he had that drawing reproduced and framed, and it hung in the lobby of every HealthSouth facility next to a large picture of himself. At the end of the year, if you were an outstanding employee, you got 100 shares of stock and you got a little red wagon, and it was called the Pulling the Wagon Award. When I wrote my book in 2009 about HealthSouth, I was trying to come up with a title. My wife said, I've got the title. I said, what's that? She said, call it HealthSouth, the wagon to disaster. As we started opening these outpatient centers, we noticed that there was a need for rehabilitation hospitals, specialty hospitals that did intensive rehab. Within a few years, it was apparent that outpatient surgery was becoming a big business. Years ago, a physician would not dare cut on you unless you were inside of a hospital. Today, 60% of all surgeries are done outpatient. You have your surgery that day, you go home that day. So as we grew HealthSouth, we had three main businesses: outpatient rehab, rehab hospitals, and outpatient surgery centers. Within 2 years, we were talking to investment bankers about going public. And I think the most important meeting in the history of the company took place with some bankers from a firm called Drexel Burnham. A couple of bankers had flown down from New York City to talk to Richard and I about the process of going public. And they spent the day with us, and at the end of the day, the lead banker said, I like the way your company looks. You seem to have a good business plan. Your facility is sharp. He said, but you're still losing money. You're a startup company. He said, we can't register your stock and take you public till we know you can make a bottom line profit in this business. He said, you tell me you're opening a lot of centers and they lose money the first few months are open. He said, I'm curious, how are you accounting for that? And I said, well, we're taking a conservative approach and we're expensing our startup costs. And with a twinkle in his eye, he said, no, no, no. Capitalize those costs. Put them on the balance sheet and write them off over several years. If you do, I think you're going to show a profit much sooner, and we'll take you public. Richard went berserk. Aaron, why are you letting the accounting tail wag the dog? I'm out here killing myself trying to get this company public, and your silly accounting is hurting the company. I'm embarrassed that this man had to fly down here from New York City and explain something so simple to you. Let me tell you what your job is as a CFO. It's to make the bottom line look as good as you can all the time, and don't you ever forget that. That was Richard's management style. He didn't mind beating you up in front of people. I redid our numbers. I ran the accounting by our auditors, and they said it was okay, but they warned me. They said, look, this is an area that could be abused. Don't you guys abuse it. And, of course, we abused the hell out of it. So starting day one, HealthSouth was probably putting things on its balance sheet that should have stayed on the P&L. But after making that accounting change, within less than 6 months, we were profitable, and we registered to go public. We filed our documents with the SEC to tentatively priced at $8 to $10 a share to sell 2 million shares. In the process, the way it works, you register with the SEC, and while they're approving your deal, you go on a roadshow. You go to New York, Boston, Chicago, San Francisco, LA, all of the financial centers. The final roadshow is always in New York. That's the big one. That's the night before you price your stock, before you start trading. It's all the big guys are there, Putnam, Fidelity, all the mutual funds. Richard made the presentation, and when he finished, he got a standing ovation. A standing ovation. And the investor sitting next to me was shaking his head, and he finally said, gosh, he said, I've never seen anything like this. He said, people don't applaud on roadshows. And he said, all my years on Wall Street, I've never seen anybody get a standing ovation. He said, you guys should not be going public. Your company is only 2 years old. Your audited top line is only $5 million. You and Richard have no track record that you can run a public company. He said, but you're going to get the deal done because Richard Scrushy is the best salesman I've ever heard on a roadshow. We got the deal done, not 8 to 10, but we went out at $6.50 a share. But within less than 6 months, we were well over $20 a share. You can do the arithmetic. I had 100,000 shares. I'd also gotten 50,000 options at $1 a share. I'm now a millionaire. Before that, I never had a net worth of $100,000. It changed me a little bit almost immediately. As soon as I could, I sold a little bit of stock and I went out and paid cash for a Mercedes. Never driven a Mercedes before. As the years went by and the stock did well, I built about a 7,000 square foot home in Birmingham, Alabama. I bought a condo in the French Quarter in New Orleans. I had 3 beach houses in Florida. Every year I bought a new Porsche, BMW, Lexus, whatever kind of luxury car I wanted. And I noticed as I traveled to New York City that all the investment bankers wore these beautiful Hermes silk ties. And I bought $30,000 worth of them. They're really good-looking ties. Now, the newfound wealth really changed Richard Scrushy. It was like this huge ego was now on steroids. I did not realize it, but he had always wanted to have a rock and roll band. So he formed a band called Proxy. And he began playing in nightclubs and at music festivals and at company events. And he wasn't that good of a singer, and the band didn't take off like he thought it should. So he went to Nashville. He bought himself a black cowboy hat. He hired people from Sawyer Brown and the Oak Ridge Boys to back him. He produced an album. He wrote a song called Honk If You Love to Honky Tonk. And he sent out memos nationwide to all of our employees telling them to call their radio station and have them play Honk If You Love to Honky Tonk. But he also started always carrying a gun in his briefcase. And as the years went by, he had bodyguards that would follow him everywhere. And he almost became kind of a Hannibal Lecter kind of guy. But in spite of these things, he was a darling of Wall Street. Six other companies went public doing essentially the same thing we did. Richard Scrisheet was given credit for starting an entire new niche in healthcare for investors to invest in. Not just starting one company, but an entire new segment for investors. People wanted Richard Scrisheet on their board of directors. He eventually was appointed to the board of trustees of the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa. Now that there were six companies doing what we were doing, we began buying up those companies. We used our stock because it always had a higher PE ratio than other our competitors, and we would simply swap our stock for their stock. And we, in the early 90s, we started doing acquisitions along the order of $500 million at a time. Here's the timeline. We started the company in 84. We went public in 86. By 1995, we were the largest company in the state of Alabama. We were operating in all 50 states. We had over 40,000 employees. We owned more outpatient centers, rehab hospitals, and surgery centers than any other company in the United States. And we were 350th on the Fortune 100 list, Fortune 500 list. I was a rock star in Birmingham. I could go into a restaurant or a club and people would recognize me. They'd want to come up, talk to me. They want to buy me a drink. I always thought it kind of odd that people want to buy you things when you're wealthy. The company started taking on some of Richard's big personality. We started buying jet airplanes. By 1995, we owned 12 jet airplanes, which Richard learned to fly. We had two Gulfstreams, which are $30 million airplanes. Many mornings, Richard and I would go to our hangar. We'd get on our Gulfstream. We'd fly up to Teterboro Airport in New Jersey. On the way up, a flight attendant would prepare us breakfast. We'd land in Teterboro. There'd be a helicopter waiting for us. It'd fly us into Manhattan. There'd be a limo waiting for us there. We'd go to the Plaza Hotel or wherever and present to investors. That night, we'd fly back home. We never had to stop in Atlanta. You have to live in the South to understand that. But it was quite the deal. You'd say, wow, what a story. Two guys with no real wealth or experience have built a Fortune 500 company in under 10 years. What could go wrong? One word, really, and that word is greed. We were very greedy. It was fun being rich, flying on our private jets and buying Hermes ties and cars and homes. Now, for Richard, it was particularly a big deal. In 1995, he told the Birmingham newspaper that he wanted to be a billionaire. He said, I hope I can become the richest man in the state of Alabama. And he totally controlled his board of directors and he gave himself millions of options every year. And he understood if he could keep that stock price going up, he could become a billionaire. I estimated in 1995 that he was worth $600 million. In 1997, he was the highest paid executive in the United States. He took home $110 million in that 1 year. Now here's what he would do. He would meet with the stock analysts every year and ask them, what do we have to earn next year for you to keep a strong buy on our stock? And they would tell him. And he would always say, we can do that. Didn't matter what our projection showed. He simply promised Wall Street good earnings, better earnings every year. It really wasn't a problem the first two, three, maybe 4 years. HealthSouth was a good company. We were making a lot of money. But over time, we could not keep up with what he was promising. So I began doing what I referred to afterwards as kind of aggressive accounting. For example, in healthcare, your biggest, trickiest area of accounting is revenue recognition, which is kind of the case in most companies. But in healthcare, because you have discounts with HMOs, Medicare, Medicaid, you have lots of bad debts, you have to do a lot of estimating to come up with your true revenue and accounts receivable. For example, our bad debt expense had been running about 10% of gross revenue, a lot of bad debts in healthcare. But I said, well, we've studied it, and it's really only 8%. And you decrease bad debt expense by 2% of several billion dollars, and it does wonders for the bottom line. When we acquired those other companies and we rolled their balance sheets into ours, we would play around with their reserves so we could bleed them into our earnings going forward. Was it fraud? I didn't feel like it was because we disclosed it. We were changing estimates, and we told our auditors we were doing it. We put it in our SEC documents, so I didn't feel like it was fraud. Now, was it good accounting? No. You don't run your numbers and say, boy, these stink. Let's just change the way we do our accounting. That's not good accounting, but that's what we did. Over time, the stock started trading down because our cash flow didn't seem to match our earnings. Our days in AR were growing. In the summer of 1996, after being a public company for 10 years and never missing earnings, we had missed them pretty badly. Bill Owens, my chief accountant, and I felt like we couldn't play with the numbers anymore. It was becoming apparent that we were doing shoddy accounting. So we made the decision to go into Richard's office and tell him that for the first time in the history of the company, we had to report numbers below street expectations. And I knew it was going to be about as much fun as telling him that he could not sing, but we went into his office and we laid it out. His face turned red and he started trembling. Get out of my office. Have you guys lost your minds? We are not going to report bad numbers. If we do, the stock's going to crash. We're going to be sued. Your stock options will be worthless. You won't be the rock stars in Birmingham anymore. He said, here's the problem. Y'all've gotten lazy. Y'all know how to fix these numbers. You've done it before. Get back in your office and get these numbers to where they need to be. Then he became a little bit civil. He said, look, guys, look, healthcare is the biggest business in the United States by far. We're barely in the acute care hospital business. We can get into that in a big way and become one of the largest companies in this country. But we can't do it if our stock's down and we're being sued and we have those kinds of problems. And then I thought he was going to get on his knees. He said, guys, there's got to be something you can do. Bill Owens, who had worked for our auditor, said, look, we have almost 2,000 general ledgers. We have that many operating units. He said, I can make entries small enough and spread them through those 2,000 ledgers. And the auditors won't look at these entries because I'll keep it small enough that it won't trip their threshold to examine these entries. And I will get the numbers to where they need to be. But he said, now, Aaron, Richard, I will be crediting revenue we did not generate. And on the balance sheet, I'll be debiting assets we do not have. Richard thought about it for a moment. He said, guys, this is our best option. We'll only do it this one time. Nobody will lose their job. Stockholders won't get hurt. And you guys know everybody does this. At that point, I should have stood up to Richard and said no. But I stand before you today telling you I was a coward. I was intimidated by Richard. I did not want to be the one to cause his net worth to go down by several hundred million dollars. And of course, there was a part of me that did not want the party to end. And I knew who would have to face the Wall Street analysts and explain why we missed our numbers. So that night, I let Bill Owens cook the books. The next day when I went into work, I felt like people are staring at me. I felt like I had blood on my hands. I did not understand what crossing that line would do to me emotionally and mentally, but from that day forward, I was pretty much a train wreck. We did it again the next quarter. 1996 ended. The auditors did not detect the fraud. Bill Owens was a very clever accountant. And we pled with Richard, tell Wall Street up front that 1997 is going to be a down year, because we're not even at where we're claiming. He wouldn't do it. He promised Wall Street another record year of earnings that I knew we could not achieve. At the end of the first quarter of 97, we had missed the numbers pretty badly. By now, about six people were involved in the fraud. We met with Richard and we decided to cook the books again. And at the end of the meeting, he did something kind of interesting. He looked us all in the eye and he said, guys, if we're ever caught, I'm going to deny everything. He said, I don't know what your game plan is, but I will deny everything. By now, I was probably on the way to becoming an alcoholic. I hated going to work for the first time in my life. I felt trapped. And I didn't want to be the whistleblower because I knew what Richard was saying. You guys cross me, I'll bring more lawyers, guns, and money to the party than you will. So I made the decision to retire. I went to Richard and I said, look, I've made a lot of money. I want to cash out and retire. He said, I think you're making a mistake, but if that's what you want to do, that's okay. So in 1997, I retired. As soon as I could, I sold all of my HealthSouth stock. I moved down to the Mobile area, about 200 miles south of Birmingham. I bought 25 acres of land, and I built a very nice house. I hoped it'd be the last house I would ever build. And I built a barn and a swimming pool and a tennis court, and I had a guest house. And for some reason, I built a football field in my backyard. I'm not sure why I did that, but I did. After being retired for almost a year, I got a phone call from Richard. He said, Aaron, come to Birmingham, have lunch with me. He said, I want to talk to you. So I drove the 200 miles up to corporate office, had lunch with him in his private dining room with his private chef. He said, Aaron, come back to work. He said, we're making our numbers fine. I know that was a problem for you. We're making them fine now. Come back to work. I want you on the team. And I told him no. And I drove back home to Fairhope, Alabama. 1998 passed, 1999, 2000, 2001, 2002. But in the spring of 2003, I heard massive accounting fraud at HealthSouth on the television. I might have just passed out for a second. When I first retired, every time my doorbell rang or the phone rang, I thought it was the FBI. But enough time had passed that I really felt like the fraud had stopped and I thought I dodged a bullet. The next day in the newspaper, Alice Martin, the attorney with the federal government in Northern District of Alabama, said that several people had come forward and admitted they were involved in the fraud, but we know of other people who were involved, and if you're one of those people, you should come forward. And I thought our next sentence was going to be, Aaron Beam, give us a call. I called around to hire a criminal attorney. I'd never hired a criminal attorney before, and one man kept being recommended, a fellow named Donald Brissman. I called him over the phone, told him my situation. He said, okay, Mr. Beam, look, let me call the feds in Birmingham. I'll call you back for the end of the day. About 2 hours later, he called back and he said, oh yeah, Mr. Beam, they want to talk to you. You be in my office at 8 o'clock in the morning. So my wife and I drove to downtown Mobile the next morning, and the first thing he said was, do not lie to me. Do not lie to the federal government. Your former employees have told them you were involved from the very beginning. The FBI has seized the HealthSouth building. if you try to lie your way out of this, you're going to prison for a long time. By now, my wife was in tears, and I was pretty upset. And I asked him, I said, do I need to give you a check today like a retainer? And he said, yes. And he said, make the check for $100,000. I said, you're kidding. And he kind of growled at me. He said, I'm not kidding. And it won't be the last check you're going to have to write me. So I'm making out the check, and I asked him. I said, man, can I get a T-shirt or something? And he gave me a coffee mug. 3 days later, I was in a federal building in Birmingham, Alabama, and I'm sitting across the table from three FBI agents, a couple of agents from the SEC, and that's not the Southeastern Conference, several attorneys from the federal government, and I am a scared puppy. I'm under oath. It's tape recorded. It lasted all day. And I didn't feel like I did well because they wanted me to remember lots of details back to 1996. And, of course, this was 2003. And a lot of stuff I just couldn't remember. But at the end of the day, the FBI agent said, Mr. Bean, we know a lot about this case. And from what we can tell today, you've been truthful. And he said, that's good. He said, so far, 17 people have come forward, pled guilty as you have today, admitted their involvement in the fraud. He says, only one key person denies knowing anything about it, Richard Scrushy. And he said, we will have to take Mr. Scrushy to trial, and we'll want you to be a witness. Now, I didn't have to go to trial. I'd pled guilty. That was it. I was just waiting for the government to sentence me to whatever time or penalties I had to pay. So the trial didn't begin for 2 years, and they wouldn't sentence me until the Scrushy trial was over. So I had 2 years that were very dark. I knew I could go to prison for 5, 10, 15 years. And because HealthSouth stock had gone down to 8 cents, investors lost billions, not millions. And everybody was saying HealthSouth surely will file for bankruptcy. And my attorney said, they're going to take restitution against you. He said, the government's going to look at your personal balance sheet, and they're going to take nearly all of it. He said, I'm not going to put you in a box underneath the freeway, but you're not going to have a 25-acre estate with a football field, and you won't be driving your $70,000 BMW. I can guarantee you that. Now, during this period, Richard did some interesting things. It was a 2-year period. He left the church that he'd been attending to, and he joined an inner city church, and he gave that church $1 million. He then purchased a small television station, and he began preaching the gospel every morning, weekday morning at 8 o'clock. And he would have other ministers come on and preach the gospel with him. He spent $20 million on his legal team. He hired a jury selection firm to handpick the jury. He had a publicist. He never entered the courtroom during the trial that he didn't have a Bible in his hand. And all during the proceedings, he would sit there with his family members and preacher friends, and they would all have Bibles. And about once a week, they'd hold church services on the courtyard steps. I thought it was kind of silly. He was obviously trying to taint the jury pool, and I thought for sure they would see through that. Now, this was the first Sarbanes-Oxley case tried in the United States. So it was a big deal, not just in Birmingham, but in Washington in particular. And the government wanted me to be the first witness. There were four CFOs after I left, but they felt like I was very professor-like. I guess it's the beard. And I would do a good job of explaining to the jurors the financial terms they had to understand because it's a financial crime. So they put me on the stand, and I'm making eye contact with the jury, and I'm explaining street expectations, earnings per share, balance sheets. They're falling asleep. They're bored out of their mind. And they literally, first day of the trial, they're falling asleep. That night on television, Richard's lawyers from Dothan, Alabama, said, look, we're not going to take this approach. We are not going to bore these poor people with stuff they can't understand. We're going to make it fun for them. He said, this trial is going to be fun. Y'all need to watch this trial. So the next day he got me on the stand. He got right up in my face. Mr. Bean, you've had an extramarital affair, haven't you? I said, yes. I was under oath and I was not going to lie. The next day, my wife wanted to come in the courtroom holding a sign saying she loved me, and we celebrated our 46th wedding anniversary this past year. And I've since learned that this lawyer's been married four times, but I digress. He then got in my face. He said, Mr. Beam, when you went to New York City and presented to investors, you lied. Mr. Beam, when you presented the numbers to the board of directors and stockholders at stockholders' meetings, you lied. You are a cheat. You are a liar. You lie so much you don't know when you're telling the truth. I looked over at the jurors and their eyes were this big. They were paying attention. They were having fun. The trial lasted 6 months. The jury deliberated for 6 weeks. Not guilty. All charges. The legal community could hardly believe it. The federal government seldom loses a case like this. And this was the first Sarbanes-Oxley case. Enron, WorldCom, Tyco, Martha Stewart, they all went to prison, not Richard Scrushy. A few days after the trial, Richard held a news conference to announce that he would be flying to Houston, Texas, to advise Ken Lay on how to conduct the Enron trial. The Birmingham newspaper interviewed some of the jurors and asked them, how was 17 people under oath, all testifying that Mr. Scrushy was at the center of the fraud, how did you find him not guilty? And some of the jurors said, those CFOs seem like liars, and Mr. Scrushy seemed like a nice Christian man. I read that and I really broke down. I couldn't believe it, that he walked. That was it. Within a few weeks, I was sentenced to prison, and I got only 3 months. And to this day, I'm not sure why I got such a light sentence, but I am human, so I didn't volunteer to go to prison longer than they told me I had to. I do have some interesting prison stories. If after my presentation, y'all want to hear them, I'll tell you, but they're really not germane to the points I want to make. I got out of prison. I'm now a felon. I am a felon today. I will be known as a felon the rest of my life. My legacy is not that I started one of the most successful companies in the history of the state of Alabama. I am the guy that cooked the books at HealthSouth. The government did take nearly all of my wealth. I needed a job, and I could not get a job. The job market for felons is not real good. So I did what I did when I was 15 years old. I earned my first dollar mowing lawns, and here I am 61 years old, and I'm mowing lawns for a living. I did it for about 3 years, and it was pretty hard on me. I don't know if y'all know what the heat and humidity is like in South Alabama in June, July, and August, but it's pretty tough. My wife kept encouraging me to call LSU, where I went to school, and see if I could go talk to the business students. She understands me real well, and she thought it'd be cathartic for me to do that. So I finally got up the courage, and I called the dean of the business school, and he said, yeah, come talk to our MBA students. And I did, and I didn't realize what I was getting myself into. I thought I'd just get up there and tell my story, but I became very emotional. I broke down and cried several times and felt like I couldn't get through the speech, but I did. And I did feel a little better, but I didn't think about doing it anymore. Enron, WorldCom, Tyco, HealthSouth, it all faded from the news. But about this time, something happened, something called the subprime debacle. We learned that millions of cheater loans were made. People were taught how to lie on loan applications so they could buy homes that they couldn't afford. The federal government, a lot of people are saying, every American ought to be able to buy a home. And the banks and the mortgage companies started lowering their lending standards, and they started creating what are now known as toxic loans. The smart guys on Wall Street packaged these loans, got them rated highly by Moody's and Standard & Poor's. While they were promoting these stocks, they were shorting them in their hedge funds. But it didn't seem to be a problem. We were in a real estate bubble, and nobody seemed to have any concerns. But you lived through it. One day, the real estate bubble burst. And almost overnight, millions upon millions of people are upside down on their mortgages. Our large banks are in trouble. Every one of our large investment banking firms are standing outside of Congress begging for a government bailout, and we're in the Great Recession, the worst since the Great Depression. And I asked myself, how did it happen? Happened just like HealthSouth. As long as you were making lots of money and nobody knew you were cheating, didn't seem to be a problem. The amazing thing about the subprime debacle is nobody understood how millions of people cheating a little compared to the large corporate frauds, what it could do to our economy, but it brought us to our knees. And this is the problem with all this. This is why we're talking about ethics. This is why you have an ethics week here. This was the cover of Time magazine in 2010. Why Main Street Hates Wall Street. Enron was voted by Fortune magazine 2 years in a row as the best company in the United States. The best company in the United States is Enron. And it just crumbled to the ground. Its accounting firm had to go out of business. And the general public started saying, how could this happen? Where were the auditors? Where are the boards of directors? How could this happen? And people lost trust in our economic system, in our business system. And trust is a very important thing. This is a slide I've discovered recently. It's written by Dr. Dan Ariely, a very renowned ethics or behavioral economist at Duke University. And he says, a society without trust isn't a society. It's a collection of people who are continuously afraid of each other. We need to improve the ethical culture in our country to bring that trust back. In 2015, I wrote my second book called Ethics Playbook, and this is an attempt to explain how these large frauds happen. Now, this is not somebody stealing $10 from petty cash. This is frauds like Enron and HealthSouth that go on for years, and they involve billions of dollars. And they're important to study because they just completely destroy the trust in our economic system. When you look at these frauds, there's somebody in the center that's kind of the leader. The Bernie Evers, the Richard Scrushy, the Tyco guy, what was his name, Kalowski. And these guys all seem to have a similar personality. They're very charismatic. They're thought of as good leaders because they can get people to follow them through their charm or intimidation. But they also have one thing in common. They measure success by how much money they can accumulate. That's it. Ethics doesn't make their radar screen. It's all about making money. Now, I like to explain all the players in this because you can't have frauds that massive. That one guy can't pull it off. He doesn't even actually make the accounting entries. He has enablers. That's what the CFO typically is. Studies do show that most large corporate frauds are started by the CEO, not the CFO. Now, why does the CFO do it? You can understand this. This is greed, power, and that kind of thing. And it kind of goes back, one of the things Dr. Ariely points out is that books don't cook themselves. Frauds are committed by human beings. So you have to understand the personality and the motivation of people. Accountants by nature, generally, are backroom people. The picture of the green visor over the ledgers is pretty true. People in accounting don't go into sales. They don't want to be out front. They like being in the back room over the ledgers or computers. But they do learn that they can advance if they can make the numbers sing. And over time, they begin to discount what they learned in school, and it can get bad enough that they cross the line and start committing fraud. Fiduciaries. There are lots of people that are supposed to prevent these kinds of frauds. Boards of directors, outside auditors, Moody's, Standard & Poor's, investment bankers, the SEC. They are supposed to look out for the public, not the company. So what happens with this group of people? Why don't they do their job? There's a thing in ethics you study, there's always conflicts of interest. And the big conflict of interest here, and it's the elephant in the room that nobody wants to admit, who compensates these people? The company does. They probably go to the same church as in play golf with the guy in the center. Particularly in the 90s, 80s, 90s, boards of directors tended to be good old boy clubs. And they did not look out for the company, they looked out for the guy in the center. Many times boards of directors were just incompetent. They just didn't do their job. Employees over time become involved. When I left HealthSouth, only about 6 or 7 people knew about the fraud. By 2003, I'm told hundreds of people knew about it. You have to when it's that large. Now, why do they do it? And I'm simplifying a lot of things here, but they do it because they don't want to lose their job. And they're proud. They work for Enron. They work for HealthSouth. These are the best companies in the country. I know they're asking me to do some screwy accounting here, but surely it's approved. And I'm not going to walk away. I think, you know, it's a great company. Suppliers and vendors know about it. And then I have this big circle called society. I do believe that our values in our society have diminished. People don't go to church as much as they used to. Our values are misplaced. We put these executives that make these big salaries on pedestals like star athletes. A football player, if he's good enough, he can punch out his girlfriend and still keep playing football. So we cut them some slack. I also think, and I'm studying it with a professor who's going to help me write a paper on it, I think the Kardashians are part of the problem. Why we put these women on pedestals and pay them so much money for no other apparent reason than having a big rear end, I don't know. I think this kind of sums up how our values have changed. In 1806, Webster published his first dictionary, and he defined success as being generous, prosperous, healthy, and kind. Today, that definition is the attainment of wealth, fame, and rank. We need to go back to the 1806 definition of success. Fraudsters don't wake up one day and say, hey, I've got a great idea, I'm just going to cook the hell out of the books. Frauds start because of some kind of pressure. In a public company, it's those quarterly earnings. I was a CFO of a New York Stock Exchange company, and the pressure to make your numbers is tremendous. On a personal level, you may cross the line and begin committing fraud because you're trying to live up with the Joneses, stay up with the Joneses. Maybe you have a gambling problem, a drinking problem, a drug problem. Maybe you have sickness in your family. But something causes you to step over the line. Frauds start small, they grow large, and there's no way out. I mentioned this guy, and my wife thinks I have a man crush on him. He's a professor at Duke University. And when he was 18 years old, he was involved in a fire and was burned very badly. And for 3 years, he's wrapped in bandages in the hospital in pain for 3 years. He got out of the hospital and he went to MIT and he earned 2 PhDs, one in psychology and one in economics. And today he's considered one of the outstanding behavioral economists in the United States. We've finally gotten smart enough to figure out you got to understand human beings to understand economics. And he's written a New York Times bestseller called The Honest Truth About Dishonesty, Why We All Lie Even to Ourselves. And in this book, he makes it very simple. He says most people, and if I asked you in this room, do you think you're a good person? Do you get up in the morning and you want to look in the mirror and say, I'm a good person? Most people do. But he says we all have a fudge factor. You will cheat a little sometimes. And the key is not to let your fudge factor grow. And he talks about how your fudge factor can grow. It depends on the type of people you associate with, the type of company you go to work for, the types of temptations you're associated with. And he goes into great detail about that. He has lots of TED Talks, lots of stuff on YouTube, and I would encourage you to get more familiar with him. He's a really brilliant guy. He talks about how we're becoming a cashless society, that he thinks that contributes to people being able to rationalize their bad behavior. Years ago, they asked a famous bank robber, why do you rob banks? And he said, because that's where the money is. Today, you can commit lots of financial crimes and never touch the cash. We have some accounting majors in here, I'm sure, and what you're being taught is to produce a set of financial statements that people can read and they can trust in those numbers. But I'm going to tell you, if you're an accounting major, your biggest challenge in life is going to be to not to succumb to the pressure of CFOs and other people who don't give a flip about how good the accounting is. They want you to make the bottom line look good. In 400 AD, St. Augustine said that complete abstinence is better than perfect moderation. What was he saying? He was saying it's better to try to be perfect, easier to try to be perfect than to walk the wiggly line. Stop and think about, what is the right moderate amount of texting while you're driving? Zero. You can kill somebody. What is the right moderate amount of cheating on your taxes? Zero. Don't do it. The right moderate amount of cheating in college, it's zero. You can't always be perfect. But when you set the bar below perfect and you rationalize that some cheating is okay, you're already on what's known as a slippery slope. I'll end my speech with a story that I think makes sense. I tell the students in college that they will, when they get out into the workplace, if they're business majors in particular, are going to incur fraud. They are going to see unethical behavior. They may already be seeing it in college, students cheating. And they need to understand how to handle those situations. In 2010, a pilot took off from LaGuardia Airport with 155 people on his plane. And you probably know the story. The birds flew into his engine and he lost all power. And he had to get that plane back on the ground. He thought about going to LaGuardia. He couldn't get back there. He thought about going to Teterboro Airport. He couldn't make it. So he landed that jet airplane with 155 living people in it in the middle of New York City on a river. I think that's more spectacular than going to the moon or winning the Super Bowl. And when they asked him how he could do it, he said, because every working day of my life, I prepared myself for this event. I studied every airplane crash, every water landing, every emergency procedure. And somehow I knew what to do when those birds flew into my engine, and I was able to do it. I tell students, birds will fly into your engine one day. And you need to have prepared yourself for that event, or you may go to prison like Aaron Beam did. Thank you all very much. Do we have time for Q&A? Do we have time for Q&A?
Just a couple questions.
Yeah.
Just for a couple questions.
Okay. Yeah. I think I went on a little too long, but if anyone would like to ask a question or two, I'd be happy to answer them. I also do have copies of my book for sale. You might say, well, look at Aaron Beam. He's still trying to get rich off of his crime. I wrote the first book because for once I wanted to stand up to Richard Scrooge and tell what really happened. As you probably know, a lot of you professors have written books. And the chance of you writing a book and it making you wealthy is about as likely as you being struck by lightning while you're on your honeymoon with Kate Upton. It's not going to happen. Yes, sir.
What's the end story on Richard?
He went to prison for bribing the governor of Alabama. And he had given the governor $500,000 of HealthSouth money. And he got appointed to a CON board that got the right to build a hospital in Birmingham. He went to prison for 5 years. He's out of prison today. That slide has nothing to do with my presentation, but it's a pretty funny slide. He has a website, richardscrucci.com. I would encourage you to go to it. It's pretty entertaining. He's written a book called When Building a Billion-Dollar Company, Here Are a Few Things You Should Think About. So he claims he knows nothing about the HealthSouth fraud. He's an innocent man, and what have you. He'll come speak to you. He spoke at Oklahoma State after I did, and he told the students that everything Mr. Beam has told you, everything he wrote in his book is a lie. I'm an innocent man, and Mr. Beam is a liar. So he and I don't speak, okay? Yes, sir. Sure. When Richard Scrucci hired me in 1980, and within minutes of me working for him, he included me in a total lie. I realize today, if that happened, if I went to work for somebody and they included me in a lie, first day on the job, I would take him to task on it. So he had conditioned me over the years to be a cheater. To be a liar. So it was, people ask you, was there a point where you crossed a line? It's much like the old analogy of the frog. You throw a frog into boiling water and he jumps out. You put him in a pot of lukewarm water and you slowly raise the temperature, he'll eventually die. And that's what happened to me at HealthSouth. I boiled my ass. Thank you all very much.